Hello, my name is Juan Trujillo. We're Team 10 and we're going to be presenting Biofuels. Along with me, we'll have David Cervantes and Joseph Coverston. So our literature survey says that an increase of 40% in worldwide energy consumption will be needed by the year 2035. In order to accomplish this goal, we will need to diversify our energy sources and we will need a bigger dependency on renewable energy sources. As you can see on our chart, by 2035, renewable sources such as biofuels will account for 7.2% of the overall worldwide consumption of energy. So we have three design considerations for biofuels. First, ethanol biofuel, then biodiesel biofuel, and also microalgae biofuels. So biofuel are fuels that are derived directly from living matter. The living matter is processed and made into a fuel, and then the fuel is later burned by vehicles, and it releases carbon dioxide back into the atmosphere, and it's an ongoing cycle. Ethanol biofuel has a history. In 1908, Henry Ford released the Model T Ford, and it was a vehicle that was capable of using ethanol fuel and gasoline, or a mix of both. The emergence of vehicles leads Rockefeller to advocate for prohibition around the same time, and the ethanol sale and possession is banned in the United States. World War I and World War II run purely on diesel and gasoline engines, and ethanol is nearly forgotten until the United States declares methyl tertiary butyl ether illegal to be used in the United States as it pollutes well water. So ethanol as a fuel is grown from non-food crops. These are crops that are grown specifically for conventional fuel sources. The byproduct waste is sold to farms as animal feed, and basically an increased awareness of effects of fossil fuels on the environment has led to higher uses of ethanol fuel. E85 is a special blend of 85% ethanol and 15% gasoline, and when that hit the market, the car industry also began to implement these changes into their fuel systems, and you can denote it by a yellow cap on the fuel tank. So here we have a basic breakdown of how ethanol is produced. After the crops are harvested, they are milled, cooked, liquefied, and fermented. After that, they are distilled and purified, and then they are blended with gasoline for the consumption of vehicles. So sugar becomes fuel in a two-stage process. Sugar first becomes ethanol through the fermentation process, and then ethanol becomes to energy when it is combusted with oxygen in an internal combustion engine. The energy and cost of the two, of both ethanol and 85-octane gasoline pretty much outweigh itself. Despite ethanol having only 26.4 megajoules per kilogram of energy, whereas gasoline has about twice as much, ethanol and gasoline prices also vary by almost the same difference. So in essence, having either ethanol or gasoline as a source of fuel, it costs about the same. However, ethanol is a cleaner source for fuel, and basically it reduces harmful impacts to the environment. Now, David is going to be talking to us about biodiesel.
Biodiesel is a renewable clean diesel burning replacement that is causing the United States to have a less dependency for foreign petroleum. It is also the most common biofuel in all of Europe as of now. And the process to making biodiesel is the process of transesterification. Yeah. In this process, there are many sources for the making of biodiesel, some as recycling cooking oil, soy oil, and algae. Okay. A little bit of history of biodiesel. Rudolf Diesel created the diesel engine back in 1890. Soon after he created his engine, he started doing experiments on an alternative fuel source for his engines, as in vegetable oil. The French government at the time became very interested in this because their colonies in Africa weren't able to obtain petroleum as easily as they would in Europe. But unfortunately, Rural Diesel was not able to fulfill this because he died in 1913, passed away in 1913. The advantages of biodiesel is that it is a renewable energy source. It's less polluting than petroleum fuel. But some disadvantages is that biodiesel is about 1.5 times more expensive than petroleum. The production for biodiesel, there are many types of production processes, but they all go through the same transesterification process. The two most common processes is the supercritical process, which uses supercritical methanol in high temperature and pressure in a continuous process. Another popular process is the ultron high shear inline and batch reactors, which also go through a continuous process, but have the option of a semi-continuous process, which reduces the time of production, but raises the volume of production. And now, Joseph with Algae.
All right. Oil-rich microalgae was first created in 1942 in order to try and alleviate the fuel shortage they had at the end of World War II. Later on, the idea was picked up again by the U.S. Department of Energy when they initiated the Aquatic Species Program in 1978 to try and achieve commercial viability of microalgae-based fuels. The results of the program, which ended in 1996, were that the high-efficiency microalgae and very resilient microalgae were mutually exclusive, so that the open pond systems that the department studied at the time ended up only working for extremely hardy versions of microalgae, which can only contain 20 to 40% lipid mass of microalgae. Okay, microalgae is the only current biofuel that will be able to displace displace petroleum as the main substitute for fossil fuel-based oils that we currently depend on. If we were to use corn or sunflower oils to try and reduce our need or completely replace our need for petroleum fossil fuels, we would need to take up about 50% of the current United States landmass. However, if we used microalgae, it would only take about 4.42% of current landmass. This is the equivalent landmass of half of Maine. Microalgae is actually 100 times more land efficient than any of the other biofuels, and the United States Department of Energy believes that in the future it will be the only biofuel which is realistically able to completely displace fossil fuels. Microalgae can in addition be completely integrated into conventional fossil fuel burning power plants in order to scrub CO2 out of those exhausts. All right, the open pond system that was studied in the Aquatic Species Program is a large open circular racetrack which allows the paddle wheel to run around the track and stir up the microalgae as it goes. The problem was with these ponds ended up being contamination and the fact that temperature fluctuation in the environment would kill off any of the non-hardy versions of microalgae. They will end up producing in these large ponds a very low lipid mass, about 20-30%. The alternative that they discovered was the photobioreactor. And the photobioreactor is a completely sealed system in which CO2 must be introduced into the system. The size of the photobioreactor is limited by chemical restraints, but it is extremely land efficient when it is used. And it can use imported CO2 from power plants in order to increase algal production. In conclusion, in order to meet the energy needs for the future, a variety of biofuel sources need to become more readily available. A single source of energy will not be able to keep up with our growing demand for energy. Biofuels provide a carbon-neutral solution to our energy needs, thus helping us mitigate risk to the environment and keep our planet cleaner.